In many of our previous materials, we've warned against receiving someone into your fellowship family just because they say they're Christian.
It's a crucial part of gatekeeping in a home fellowship family to kick the tires beforehand to make sure the person is born again.
One of the foremost responsibilities of gatekeeping before you establish fellowship is to discover their view of the Bible.
This is so important that we want to review some foundational truths of how our Heavenly Father would have each person in your fellowship family view His Word.
Each person needs to view the Bible as our Father's authoritative commands for how each of you must live in union with Christ by His Spirit.
It's crucial that no one treat His commands as mere suggestions. Consider the source. Our God doesn't suggest.
No one should minimize how indispensable the Old Testament is to your faith journey in Christ.
Our Lord's earliest followers relied totally on the Old Testament because the New Testament hadn't been written yet.
Please take this to heart. If you don't mutually agree on the Bible as God's unchanging truth, the harmony of your fellowship family will be disrupted.
Disagreement over whether the Bible alone is God's authoritative word is one of the reasons there are so many denominations and sects within Christianity.
Here are some points about the Bible to help you understand how our Father views His Word and to recognize your responsibility to Him and to each other who follow Jesus as Lord.
All Scripture is God-breathed and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be complete, having been thoroughly equipped for every good work.
The only Scripture Paul is referring to is the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures. That was the only Bible in existence at the time. The Hebrew Scriptures were the foundational truth on which Jesus and the Newer Testament writers established their teaching. God didn't divide His Word into two separate ways of revealing Himself. He planned it to be a unified representation of His person, His will, and His ways.
It was man who created division by relegating the Old Testament as ancient history and regarding the New Testament as the only valid text for Christians.
But both biblical accounts are necessary. The Old Testament is the foundation for understanding our Father and how He wants us to live.
And our understanding of God's redemptive plan in the Old Testament is clarified in the teaching and commands and life of Jesus.
Both Testaments reveal God's grace, His awesome power, and His loving compassion for humankind.
Let's look at one crucial truth from the Old Testament and see how it affected the lives of those who first put their trust in Jesus.
From Genesis through Revelation, we're constantly reminded of humanity's propensity to sin.
Because of God's perfect holiness and justice, our sins violate Him, and we fully deserve the death penalty for what we've done and failed to do. But it was through His amazing grace that He showed the Israelites just how heinous the penalty for their sin is.
In Leviticus chapters 1 through 4, God introduces to Israel the whole concept of sin's terrible consequences from His perspective.
His chosen people deserved death for their sins, But our gracious God was willing to accept a substitute for the life of the person who sinned.
Because God is gracious, He ordained the process of the sin offering. The first step required the person who sinned to offer an unblemished animal at the door of the tabernacle. The priests were waiting near the altar. The offerer himself placed his hands on the head of the animal, confessing his sins. And that way, his sin was transferred to the animal substitute to become sin on his behalf, as he identified with its necessary death.
The person making the offering then had to kill the animal with his own hands. Picture what a bloody and emotionally difficult experience this was.
The blood spattered all over his hands and his robe and his sandals as he witnessed the life fade from the terrified animal's eyes. The substitute's life in exchange for his life.
That process was intentionally graphic visual image of how detestable sin is from God's perspective.
God is fully aware of the death of even a sparrow, so he is pained by the intentional slaughter of an animal he's created so that the sin of a person can be atoned for.
Yet even this bloody act was evidence of the mercy of a holy God who allowed a sinless animal to substitute for the sinner himself.
The Newer Testament cites crowds who heard John the Baptist, Jesus, and Peter at Pentecost speak about repentance of their sin. They weren't hearing something new.
These Jewish people who first placed their trust in Jesus knew the Older Testament.
They clearly understood that repentance is the first step toward being reconciled with our Father.
They understood that repentance means forsaking their sin and turning to Father God for forgiveness.
And because they clearly realized that God doesn't set aside His righteousness for anyone, they knew that the penalty for sin is severe.
So when you think of what our Lord Jesus accomplished on your behalf, picture it this way.
Through your sin, you brought the sinless sacrifice to the cross.
You nailed Jesus to the cross so that he suffered in agony and died out of love for you.
It's your heartfelt gratefulness and your heart-rending sorrow for what your sins caused that is the first step to being born again.
It's that mix of love and sorrow over the detestableness of your sin that helps you internalize Paul's words to you.
Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death.
We've presented just one spiritual truth from the Old Testament to help you grasp a newer covenant truth being fulfilled in Jesus.
In our next video, we'll review how this mingled sorrow and appreciation affect your relationship with your Heavenly Father and with each other.
In light of just this one point, ask yourself, did our Father mean for the Old Testament to be any less important for me than it was to those who first followed Jesus?